So it's me, Nicolette Mashile, and today I want to talk a little bit about some mistakes that a lot of us make when we are buying rental properties for investment purposes, right? Remember that none of my videos constitute as financial advice. If you are looking for financial advice, please speak to somebody who is certified and registered with the FSCA. So I had the greatest opportunity over the last weekend to speak at the South African Property Show, or the Property Show SA. And it is hosted by Private Property. There, you know them, those guys who tell you which properties are available to buy or to lend, to rent, and you can, yeah, those are the guys, right? So they are the platform that connects the real estate agencies to buyers, or you as a buyer to a real estate agency, whatever. Right, so I had the opportunity to speak at the Investor Theatre, and basically at the Investor Theatre, I spoke a little bit about the property stock file or collective buying. I'll speak about that in a different video. And then I had an opportunity to speak at the Standard Bank Buyer Theatre. And there is where I spoke a little bit about some of the mistakes that a lot of us make, a lot of us, even the seasoned property investors still make these mistakes. But with a little bit of experience in literature, you start to understand where you can make sure that you do not have, and I call this thing the degree of wrongness. I was speaking a little bit about how property is a type of asset that is not a timed asset, right? A lot of people will say, you gotta time it well, right? You gotta time the buying. So you gotta buy low and sell high, right? Or you gotta look for a bear market or a bull market, and that's when you can invest in different things. So I think property, yes, it might have elements of the when to buy, but I think more than anything, property is how to buy. The more you know of how to do certain things when it comes to buying property, the more you diminish that degree of wrongness when it comes to property. So I think that's really important. But I will outline at the end of the video some of the top things that I think a lot of us do when it comes to property that could potentially be a mistake. But before I carry on, we do have literature in South Africa. Jason Lee has written a book of Making Money Out of Property in South Africa. If you want to be a property investor, even if you're a first-time buyer, it's really worth reading that book before you buy. In a previous video, I spoke about how you need at least 12 months leeway before you start buying. And guys, I know it sounds exaggerated, but it is not. Buying property is an important step. It's a big purchase, so you've got to be emotionally ready for it, but also financially ready. And there are ways in which you can be clever around this thing, right? So I think 12 months is long enough and adequate. I, for instance, in my book that is coming out soon, guys, I promise it's going to come out soon. I'm still cooking. I'm still kneading. I want it to be pretty. I want it to be good. I don't want those A to B mistakes, you know? I'm sorry to the Queen Bee fans. But yeah, so that's what I want to do. That's what I'm doing with the book. But I do write a chapter in the book about how much I hate my house, right? The chapter's called I Hate My House, because for me, my house was an impulsive buy. It was really expensive. I think that I followed some of Jason Lee's steps, yes, but when I look at it now, I'm like, hey, Jason Lee, that step didn't make sense though. That's a good guideline, but I think that a lot of us need to rethink it. And I think you learn these things. I mean, yes, obviously the guys who write the books around property and the people who do talks around property will say what they know and say what they have experienced. But I think a lot of us, we experience different things when it comes to property. For instance, this location thing for me, you've got to like take it with a pinch of salt, because yes, fine, you've got to buy property in great location where properties are actually, appreciating, the value of the location is doing well or it's stable. But at the same time, you don't want to buy in a too expensive location that you experience what is called location tax. And I write about this in the book. You get location tax. If you, like, for instance, a couple of weeks ago, my geyser burst. And before I knew that we actually had insurance, I had called around to find out how much a geyser would be and to the labor. And I got different prices. So I eventually stopped saying where the venue is, where the actual estate is. And all of a sudden, I got different prices. So when I said the place is in Randburg, I got a different price. When I said it's in Bryanston, I got a different price. When I said it's in Four Ways, I got a different price. And by the way, the price is not based on the distance. The price is based on the location. So you get charged location tax. And for me, that doesn't make sense. But I've got top three things that I think that a lot of us need to think about when we are buying property, especially when you're buying property as an investor. right? We'll do a separate video where we talk about mistakes to avoid when you're a first-time buyer for a property that you want to live in. But I think more than anything, you know, the common mistakes is make sure that you sign the OTP and read the OTP, edit the OTP, make sure that you've got additional, you know about all the additional costs, make sure that the house is in good condition because of footstool clause. Make you know all those things, the basic things. But I think once you've actually bought, you start to realize, and once you actually start running a rental business, you start to know the other mistakes. And I think the first common mistake a lot of us make is that we buy property in our own name when we are trying to rent it out. And yeah, that may seem very cool that it's your name, you can say that's my property, but you can still do the same thing if the property is bought in a business that is your business, right? The reason why you should buy property in a different entity, in a juristic entity, separate from yourself, is because of liability. So you want to strip yourself away, or you strip the property away from any potential liability that you might hold. So let's say, for instance, you buy the property now. So the two types of liability. You buy the property now and you buy it in your name. You get married. You marry badly. This person that you've married has dikoloto, debt, wire. You married in community of property. Then they get, and then they get over indebted and the debtors come to attach their assets. And you guys are married, they're going to attach your house also. So those are the things that you need to avoid. Or you get over indebted, or the you yourself get over indebted, and as I said again, you come and you get stripped away of those properties. Or you get married, you get a divorce, and now you gotta give half of your property to another person. I mean, really, no, okay? No, not gonna happen. I got like 5 properties, imagine. Anyway, going back to what are some of the reasons why you should be buying in an incorporated entity is also for tax reasons. You want to pay as little tax as possible. Most people that can afford to buy properties are moving towards a higher tax bracket, or the rental income could push you into a higher tax bracket, because remember, all your income is seen by SARS, right? So that's also something that you've got to just keep at the back of your mind. Then the second mistake that a lot of people who buy property for investment purposes make is that they don't run it like it's a business. And you've got to run it like a business. You've got to make sure you manage your cash flows. You've got to make sure you know that you are putting that money in a business account where you're not keeping on tapping into it, because that's the only way you're going to know whether or not this property is actually a liability or it's becoming an asset that gives you an income. Because how do you trace whether this property is actually making you money or bleeding you money if it's mixed masala with your salary and it's in your check account and it's just a mess in there? So rather you have a separate account and a business account for this thing, and you are running it like it's a business. But at the same time, you cannot be a medical doctor, for instance, and not know how to prescribe medication or what the law is around prescribing medication. So the same thing with when you are renting properties out, you cannot be a landlord that doesn't know the PIE Act. How do you evict somebody? What is the law when it comes to evicting people? Or you do not know the Rental and Housing Tribunal Act, so you don't know how to put together a lease. All your leases are actually unlawful. So it's important that you know the law, you understand the law, you know your rights as a landlord, but also you know what rights your tenants have, because this will really come in handy if issues do arise. And let me tell you, as much as tenants are your business, tenants can also become a nightmare. So you've got to know the space that you're in so that you can stay as compliant as possible. And then last but not least, before this video becomes long, remember that you do have tax incentives. So there's 2 types of tax incentives when you are investing in property. The first one is that SEX 15, I can't remember what the actual clause is. I will look for it. And that clause talks about if you buy 5 properties that are new development properties, and you are renting them out, SARS gives you a huge incentive, a huge deduction. But also, even now, if you do have a rental property and you got it as a on a bond, you can actually, if you got it on a bond, you can get deductions for the interest that you are charged on that bond. So again, another thing that you need to remember. So yeah, I'll close this video here because it's becoming a little long. I'll do a separate video on property stock files, and then I'll also do a separate video and on mistakes that you can avoid when you are a first-time buyer. Okay, I hope that was enough information for the property investor.